you. All right. Well, it is our joy to have the Jason Russell family with us. So I'm going to ask Brother Russell to come. Are we good to go on the presentation? Everything, John? Good. All right. We just need to get the lights back here when he's ready. All right. We'll do that. But excited to have them here. As I've told you many times, he is just a good friend. And he's the only missionary that I've been on the field with in their place of service. And it wasn't there for one day. You know, you can put on a show for a day. I stayed a month. And we made it through it. No Dr. Pepper, but I did have my Dr. Pepper Jelly Belly jelly beans with me. And ration them through the whole month. Every couple, you know, every day, take a couple of them. We survived. We made that 12-pack of Cokes last a whole month, too. That's amazing. But anyway, Brother Russell, you come. Introduce your family, if you would. And then when you're ready to start the presentation, let me know. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you very much.
Make sure your mic's on.
Yes, sir. Okay. I think we're good.
Yes, we are.
All right. It's good to be with you. It's good to be with your pastor again. And his family. We've had sweet memories there in San Diego together, and just remarkable, remarkable life. And we've been serving in Papua New Guinea since 2000. God allowed us to go on deputation in 1998, October of 98, and get to the field in June of 2000. And we've served in the lowlands or the swamps of Papua New Guinea all that time. And we started on an island called Daru. Daru is 2 miles in diameter, just a little bitty place, well, 25,000 people. But it's a little island. We built a radio tower 2 years ago, and I climbed on top of that tower to put the antenna on, and up there you could look around the whole island. And so that's just a small place, but God's given us a remarkable ministry on that island. We're able to turn that church over in 2005 and went on to the mainland, just 60 miles by air, 60 nautical miles, to another place called Weeping, and that's the place your pastor has come to visit with me. And the fact that he survived is amazing because my wife and children were not with us. It was just he and I. Oh, yeah. Ooh. We were cooking. Or whatever you call that. But we have some sweet memories and just a great time. Our men who were in the Bible school, he came to teach in our Bible school and to help me in some areas where I felt weak in. And I definitely felt weak after he was there. And just a remarkable Bible teacher your pastor is, and so helpful to our people. And out of that Bible school, we've had 7 graduates out of there. And several of those have planted churches or are pastoring today in village churches. We're thrilled about that. And your pastor's had a unique influence upon them. 2 years ago something now, we went back to the island of Daru. There was some trouble in that church there. We had to go back. Similar to like Paul had to keep on going back and confirm the saints and so forth. And we've been back there for 2 years to help raise up some new leadership in the church and strengthen those things that we're wanting, if you would. And God's given us, again, just an amazing time there. Several hundred people saved while we've been there. Our church is growing again and doing very well. I say very well. I'm here. They're there. I would like to be there and participate in it. Even right now, we miss them greatly. But God's given us a unique ministry. I've said that a few times, and I guess that's the only word I can use, is just unique. And we're going to show a video that'll, most of it will be about the Weeping ministry, you'll see in just a moment, but it also has some of the Daru ministry as well. All right, if you have a question that you'd like to ask, maybe you see something that you say, well, what's that? We'd love to interact with you. We'd love to answer your question if you've got one. My children will be available. My wife and I will be available. Don't be scared of us. We are scared of you. Don't be scared of us. We'd like to help. Some people ask, why do missionaries show videos? I want to illustrate with you, but I need your help. Put your hand out like this, like you're pointing to the sun. Okay, anyways, wherever the sun is. All right, now get your finger just like this. Why do missionaries show videos? This is why. Now put this shape on your chin. Now how many of you put it on your chin? You did. Good job. You see, the Bible says, mine eye affecteth my heart. And if it didn't affect your heart, it did affect your actions anyways. And we show video presentation slides, etc., because we are a visual people. And boy, you can... They say a picture is worth 1,000 words. Well, what's a video worth? You know, how many pictures are in there? And we hope that it will stir your heart to remember those in Papua New Guinea, to pray for us, and even to go. I think in your bulletin today, your pastor addresses a great point in there about sending and going and praying and all that stuff. I hope you read it and take heed to it. All right. Make the volume a bit loud and the room dark. It would be great. Here we go.
Thy will and not my will be done. My heart be ever thine. Confessing thee, the mighty word, my Saviour Christ, my God, my Lord, thy cross shall be my sign.
It's been my belief that my ministry of church planting, my focus is on the Bible school, training these men to do what I do, to be who I am. I think that's what Jesus did. He chose 12 to reproduce himself, if you would. And he said, greater works shall you do because I go unto my Father. And it is my philosophy, maybe you could say it that way, that these Bible school men are the best avenue to indeed reach these places and people.
All my life I've lived a life that was miserable, a miserable life I lived, and a life was not good in God's eyes. And I was a man who mobilized some groups in doing bad things, and I was one of those guys who was a leader in the area. And there was a revival meeting held at Whitman Baptist Church. I attended that revival meeting, and as soon as the preaching came on, it was like the preaching was only for myself. I was thinking, that preacher, you better stop preaching right now. I called for invitations for me to come up. So he did that, and I was able to accept Christ as my personal Savior. And from that time, God took me for Bible school. I don't know how I got there, but there was applications given out by Brother Jason, and then I was one of them to see one, and I just put my name in. I grasped a lot of things from Bible school, and that's where I came to know God personally, and God gave me a fire in my heart where I was able to go out and win others, just as someone wanted me to Christ.
Oftentimes they ask me, are people receptive there to the gospel? And I'll say, yeah, people are indeed receptive to the gospel, but they're hardened just like they are in any other place. Sin is the great deceptor. Sin deceives the heart of people to think that everything's okay, nothing's wrong with them. They'll get everything sorted out in the end. So our people are just like that. In the village side in Weeping, just looking at us, people would stare. Actually, when we built our house in the evening time, people would come sit out on the road and they would just stare at us, look in our house and see what we were doing. And well, the gospel work was seriously difficult to break through, not only the culture, but of course the language. Well, we began to preach and teach, and after some time we saw a few saved. And you know, we got there in 2005, but we didn't baptize our first convert. I think it was until late 2007. When we built our building, we built it to seat 300. We built it because there are 300 people in our area, and I want every one of them to know the Lord, and I want every one of them to have a place at Weeping Baptist Church.
When we went to Daru, that people really were very quick to, you know, open to us, and things moved very quickly. The church grew quickly. A lot of people got saved. It was, what would we say, ministry.
Everything you do takes, I think, extra labor. It's not like you just jump in a car and go to the store. When we need a 2x4, I have to make a deal with the landowner. We'll go out there, chop the tree down with a chainsaw, bring the sawmill out with our tractor, and then mill the tree up, and not just get one 4x2, but maybe get 100 4x2s. And that's what we do to build. You know, missionaries are sometimes given unique opportunities based upon the places and the environment in which we serve and the needs of our people. One of those special needs in our area is regular clean water. For us, if it doesn't rain, we do not have clean water for drinking. And I researched purchasing a small bore water drilling machine. We have now drilled 13 bores in Dara and Weeping, supplying clean water to thousands. Mission work is a very physical work. We use chainsaws, sawmills, our physical strength. We sweat. It takes a lot of hard work to do the work of the ministry.
Well, the verse we use on our presentations and on our letterhead is out of Thessalonians. Finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified with us as it is with you. We need the Word of God to have free course here. It's a spiritual battle. So we need you to pray for us. And you know what? We really appreciate hearing that that you do. We have some supporting churches that send us a card every month with signatures of people who have prayed for us that month. And we appreciate that. At times we do feel like we're forgotten, and so when we get those mails, it picks us up. And you were here when we received mail, and you saw my family was surrounding that box, and it didn't matter what was in it, but just the idea. When I would go to the post office in Daru with the key, I'd open the box, and if I see something inside, we'd sing the song, "Somebody Loves Me," and so now Anna on her Gmail account, whenever Gmail goes off, that's what it says, "Somebody Loves Me." And so we like to know that we're remembered.
Our joy to serve God in Papua New Guinea. Don't feel sorry for a missionary. We're there by choice. Some people feel, oh, sorry, you had to go to... No. It's a choice that we've surrendered to do. One of the men you saw in here, you saw him witnessing. He was sitting like this, and he had a gospel tract. Remember that part? His name is Job. He was also behind the pulpit one time, and he was kind of teaching. When your pastor was with us back in 2009, he was teaching on church history, Baptist history, and he was telling showing the heritage, our Baptist heritage in America, and even in his family, how he's got people in his family line who were preachers and so forth. And Job just started weeping, shoulders shaking, weeping. And after the class, he asked Job, "Job, why were you crying like that?" He says, because we don't have that heritage. We don't have that history in our first generation Christians. Powerful. Powerful. Missions is so exciting. One of the joys, and also it could be a shame as well, but one of the great joys is just about everything they know about God and church and songs and all this stuff, they learn from us. Sometimes I'll sit in the pew and one of the preachers will be up preaching and he'll do something or say something and oh boy, I wish he wouldn't have learned that from me, you know, or look up here or something like that. And sometimes they'll do something just like, wow, they got that. Such as this, a statement, we are not saved to sit, we are saved to...
Sure.
How'd you know that? Well, they know it too. But they would not have known it if, one, they hadn't got saved,
yeah,
and two, they hadn't been in church, and they hadn't heard the preacher say, hey, don't just sit, we need to serve the Lord.
Right.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Open your Bible with me to the book of Acts, chapter number 14 this morning. I've got about 20 minutes or so, and so we're going to make this 40-minute lesson into 20 minutes. So I'm going to talk fast. You listen fast. Just don't get done before I do. All right. I think we're ready here.
Almost.
All right. You'll
technical difficulties,
but that's okay. Acts chapter 14. As they're getting that ready to go here, we'll get this ready to go here. Acts chapter 14. It is a joy to be here. Thank you so much for Pastor letting us come. It's our honor to be here, honor to speak. Some pastors feel sorry that missionaries have to travel around the country and so forth, and sometimes it does get laborious. But it's honestly, it's for me, it's like a medicine. Sometimes with my family, it is laborious. But for me, it's a medicine to be able to stand before you and tell you what God's doing on another side of the world, how God has brought faith to the Gentiles. Amen, to the heathen, if you would. Acts chapter 14, we're not going to preach about that. It's going to work out here, don't worry. Acts 14 and line number 21. I've never taught this lesson with the slides, I just made this today. So if we don't have it, that's okay, but it would be nice if we could. Acts 14, line number 21. Are we there together? We'll give the Baptist sign. Are we there together?
Hey.
Amen. All right, now as the teaching comes forth or preaching, if something hits you good, you say amen. If something hits you bad, you say, oh me. All right. Acts 14, verse number 21 says, and when they had preached the gospel to that city. By the way, that's why they went.
Right.
Amen. They didn't go just to drill a well. They didn't go there just to cut some trees down. They went there to preach. Amen.
Right.
So when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. And when they had ordained them elders in every church and had prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord on whom they believed. And after they had passed through Pisidia, they came to Pamphylia. And when they had preached the word in Perga, they went down into Italia and thence sailed to Antioch, from whence they had been recommended to the grace of God for the work which they fulfilled. And when they were come and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. And there they abode long time with the disciples. One other passage, chapter 15, verse number 30. Oh, 5, verse 35. It says, Paul also and Barnabas continued in Antioch, that's the home church there, sending church, teaching and preaching the word of the Lord, and many others also. It wasn't a unique thing where they just had two preachers. No. This was a common something in the first church there of Antioch. Amen? Common. With others also. Verse 36, and some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, hey, Barney, let us go again, huh? Let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they do. All right. I'm going to answer the question today that you haven't asked but maybe is on your mind. Why do missionaries return home? Why do they come home on a furlough? Why don't they just stay there where God has sent them? Well, the reasons are multiple. And I'll just say this, not only for their own sakes do they return home, but they also return home for the sake of others. I'm going to give us maybe five biblical reasons for missionaries returning home. Are you ready with me? Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right, here we go. The first one is right here, or right there. There we go. The first one is to, what's it say? To reconnect. There we go. To reconnect. In verse number 26, it says, and thence they sailed to Antioch. I'll tell you this this morning on a practical level. After some time in a foreign environment, if you're not careful, you can adapt negatively to that environment, to that society. If the society is always angry and cross, you may become angry and cross. If the society is promiscuous, whoa, you may, after some time, as Lot was vexed his righteous soul from day to day, you also may justify that behavior after some time. Let me say this morning. It is good for a missionary to come home to reconnect for the sake of his marriage. There we go. We're trying to adapt here. For the sake of his marriage. We'll just say it like that. There we go. We got it. Whoa. Okay. There we go. It's looking right there, but it's not looking right here. For the sake of his marriage. You know, marriages can get strained on the foreign field. I had a good friend of mine. Matter of fact, he was the best man. Well, why do we say that in my wedding? What's that? Where does that leave the groom, you know? The guy on the side, my best friend that was, I can't even say that because, you know, where does that leave the wife or the bride? I don't know why we say that. We need to come up with a different word. Let's have a conference this afternoon and discuss this. We'll get the right word in here. The guy that was standing on my side that had a great impact on my life and influence on my life, he was my high school teacher. He was my prayer partner. We'd pray all night, some nights. We'd fast together, etc. He was in our wedding. He became a missionary to Alaska. After the first term, we were just about getting ready to go to New Guinea on our first term. They were home on a furlough type of thing. And we sat with them, and his wife mentioned to us that her husband had become rough with her. Sometimes physically rough, not you know, fighting and things like that. Sometimes verbally rough with her. Hey, do this. Hey, do that. You know, in Papua New Guinea, they don't say please. Please is not in the vocabulary. And you're welcome is not even in the language. You get what I'm saying? And so in a marriage relationship, sometimes it's good to come home just so we can reconnect and get back to what is, this is the proper behavior. Let's be reminded this is proper marriage behavior. Amen? Amen? Good. I'm just saying on a practical basis, it's good to come home to reconnect for the sake of your marriage. We're taught oftentimes in American conferences, couples conferences and things like that, that a husband ought to take his wife out on a date at least
once a week.
How impractical is that? Brother, you've been where we live.
Yes,
what do we go, visit the birds and say hello to the bees? What are we going to do here? You know, there's nowhere to go. One time my wife and I were having some struggles. I called my pastor. I was in the city. I was able to use a phone. I said, Pastor Fisher, my Ann and I are not on the verge of divorce, but I want you to know we're having some struggles. I just want you to be in the loop here. Pray for us. And so he began to kind of give me some counsel, some advice on some things that I could do to help our marriage. He says, you think you could let her maybe go for a drive? I said, well, I've taught her how to drive the tractor, but it's not something she really enjoys doing. And then he went on to say, and this is not saying anything bad against Pastor Fisher, okay? He just didn't understand our environment. He said, can you let her go shopping? I said, well, no. There's no post office. There are no stores. No. All those things did not exist where we live. And he did come up with some helpful things, and I did do that in the sense of I bought some Christian womanhood thing and what's that sort of. Yeah, sword of the Lord, thank you. Got stuff like that coming in, and revival fires, just to help us get out of our environment a little bit. And there's always some little articles in there regarding marriage and relationships and so forth. Do you follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So missionaries come home for the sake of marriage. Secondly, come home to reconnect for the sake of not only marriage, but also children. Children. Children become very much adapted to the environment in which they grow up in. My son is 17, our oldest daughter is 19, youngest is 15. We've spent 15 years in Papua New Guinea. Most of what they know is Papua New Guinea. Do you understand what I'm saying? They can put on the accent. And it sounds funny to us, but it's normal to them and to their friends. And they can adapt some of the negative things about that society. Although, I'll say this, we have skirted some of the negative culture of America by being in a foreign land. And that's also been helpful, too. Amen. The main culture our children know is the Russell culture. This is what we do. But I'm going to give you an analogy, an example of what missionary kids, how they grew up on the foreign field. All right, here we go. And even adults as well. We come from the country of blue. We go to the country of yellow. Because we're blue, we struggle with connecting with the people of yellow. And we study them, and we try to learn their ways. We sit with them, we sing with them, we eat with them. We try to learn the culture of yellow. And after some time, although we're not yellow, we become less blue and we become more yellow so that we might be able to preach to them and help them and understand where they are. Where our kids grow up the same way. They have blue parents, but they have yellow friends. And because they're blue and their friends are yellow, it's awkward. And so, of course, they want to adjust and to adapt to be like the yellow people. But, of course, they can never be yellow because they're blue. But after some time in that environment, they are neither blue nor yellow. Now they are green. Catch this. It's time to return home from the country of yellow. And they come back to the country of blue. And they come back to the country of blue. People expect them to be blue because their parents are blue. But indeed, they're not blue. They're green, so they don't really fit in here either. They call them third culture children. My kids are kind of smiling about this thought. Yeah, Dad, we understand. So we come home to reconnect for the sake of our children, to help them understand. Because hear this. My oldest two kids, 17 and 19, they don't get to go back to New Guinea. They're coming back to America to stay, unless God were to call them back after. And when they're 23, they can return. But the government of Papua New Guinea says, you must leave at 18. Thankful to get an extension for Libby so she could remain with us. But now Titus and Libby will not be able to return. Can you imagine being a green person coming to the country of blue and trying to adjust here? You pray for them. That's one of the reasons why missionaries return home, is for the sake of their children. I'll say thirdly, missionaries return home to reconnect not only for marriage and children, but also for doctrine's sake. You know, living in that environment, and be tried and tested and pressured and all that stuff, you can get to the place where you forget where you stand. And don't criticize your missionary too hardly, because you also can forget where you stand.
Yes,
if you're out in that environment too long, you don't come back into the house of God, you say, whoa, what am I? I'm green now. There have been times, Brother Vandenberg, where... And this is maybe why, one of the reasons why I asked you to come back then, where missionary, I'll speak on my own behalf here, they can forget even how to preach. Because I'm teaching so much, because our people know nothing. They don't know who Abraham is. They don't know who Lot is. You know, so you're doing all this teaching, because preaching without a biblical understanding is just your opinion. And people are not going to take it as the Word of God because there's no biblical basis for what you just preached. Do you follow what I'm saying there?
Right.
So we do a lot of teaching that we might do preaching. But there have been times when my wife would get on to me and she says, Jason, can't you just haul off and preach? Like, boy, I'm feeling terrible inside. I'd like to, but I forget how to do that. I forgot. And so it's good that we were listening to preaching this morning in the motorhome there. Man, somebody was letting loose, man. Let a rip potato chip. It was at a youth camp, and man, he was preaching about if you want to serve God, you got to be saved, and you got to be separated, and you got to be serious. I mean, that's preaching. Man, I love that. Your pastor's a preacher.
Amen.
I love listening to him preach because he can preach. You pray for your missionary. One of the reasons why they return home is that they can reconnect doctrinally. I've got more to say there, but I'll move on quickly here. Another reason why a missionary would return home is not only to reconnect, but also to rehearse. Verse number 27 in our text, chapter 14, verse 27, says, "And when they were come and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles." You know, there was a time when a missionary comes home, a time to tell stories. Isn't that what life's made up of? I tell a story, and that reminds you of something, and you tell a story, and that'll remind me something, but I'll tell a story, and we can just sit together, and we can tell stories all day long. Yes. And in Papua New Guinea, what do? We gossip. No, I mean, we tell stories all the time. Look out. You think ladies in America have a problem with gossiping. Our ladies can put you to shame. They know how to do it properly, or improperly. Anyway, they can do it. But boy, when it seems like when Paul and them came back, they began to tell stories about what God had done. And don't you want to hear the missionary come home and tell the story about how no one got saved? You want to hear that story? You want to hear the story about Job, how he got saved under a mango tree, and then God put in his heart a desire to study the Word of God. He came to Bible school, and then God put a fire in his heart to preach and see the tears come down his cheeks while someone's teaching about Baptist heritage and so forth. He just starts weeping. Man, he's got a desire. He wants to go plant a church. Amen. And you see him leading people to Christ. I got goose pimples all over my arms talking about it. Yeah. You want to hear that story? Because that'll strengthen your faith. You hear the story about Renagi, where you saw in the video again how we led him to Christ during a revival meeting. And boy, he got on fire, came to Bible school, put a desire in his heart to see his own people saved, went to his village, Padari, to start a church, and you saw some of the congregation there that he was standing next to. Boy, those are sweet stories. They came home to rehearse all that God had done. Paul specifically, I think, if you check chapter 13 out, you'll see how he probably told a story about the conversion of Sergius Paulus. And we won't get there. Our time is quickly vanishing away, but the conversion of Sergius Paulus, and then the confrontation he had with Elymas the sorcerer, how he resisted and he tried to turn the deputy from the faith, and Paul said, "You're going to be blind, not seeing the sun for a season." And he was blind. In verse number 12 of chapter number 13, you'll find this fellow says, "Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord." Boy, the conversion, the confrontation, the challenge, the change, the contradiction, the conflict, all that stuff is inside of this chapter, chapter 13. And these are the stories that when Paul and Barnabas came home, they came home to tell the church about all these things. They came home to rehearse. But let me go on to say this. They came home to report as well. You are not a financially supporting church of ours yet. Hopefully one day you may be. But if you are, when we come home to give, as it were, a financial report. We come home to tell you what God has done with the resources that you have invested in Papua New Guinea. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's almost like a business meeting. By the way, a missions conference is a business meeting deciding the fate of the world. We get to choose. We get to choose what goes on, how far the light will shine. If we're going to send the light, we've got to pay the light bill. Is this too practical this morning? That's just how it works. If we want these lights to shine, we got to be faithful. And if you want the light to shine to a foreign land, hey, the farther the light shines, it's gonna take extra fuel to do that. Come home to report. I think they came home to report how they were doing personally. Verse number 27 says they rehearsed all that God had done with them. What God had done with them. How they were doing personally. You know, service on a foreign field takes its toll on your missionaries. Not discrediting or making little the pressures that are put on an American pastor, but an American pastor can simply pick up a phone and call a friend down the road, another town. Maybe he could take a drive and see a pastor friend of his and be encouraged and have his iron sharpen iron. But a missionary doesn't necessarily get that. You follow what I'm saying? I mean, people have asked, you know, do you have any other missionaries around? Not really. The Highlands is where most of the missionaries are, and we're down on the coastal region. Your pastor's been there. He understands what I'm saying. Rehearse how they were doing personally. But I'll say also, to rehearse how the work was going specifically. The question that was wanted, that begged to be answered, is: had God opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles? Are the Gentiles receiving faith just like we have received faith? And the resounding answer that Paul gave was yes, indeed, he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. It is good for you to go visit your missionary, or at the very least, put in the budget to send your pastor to go visit a missionary, so he can indeed verify and say, indeed, these people have received the same faith we do. The same Holy Spirit inside of my heart convicting me of sin and of righteousness and of judgment to come is the same Holy Spirit gone into their heart. I was so excited one time we were making a missions trip. You know, we're on mission field, but we still make missions trips, all right, to a village. And I took one of our Bible school students with us. His name was Kumbin Kumbin. He is now a graduate and a pastor of a church that he started in a village called Sui. But we were together. I would take them, one or two of my Bible school students with me, and we would go. And of course, at the end of the day, what are you going to do before you lay down to bed? Pray. Amen. God bless you, brother. That was good. I was thinking about taking a shower, okay? You got to wash off the sweat from the day. And most people in the village, they just go down to the creek and do it. But whenever they wanted to go down, I said, whoa, guys, see that moon? I glow in the dark. Uh-uh. Not going. Yeah. You get what I'm saying? Trying to be practical here. But praise the Lord, Brother Kumbin also, he said, I'm not going down there. We're going to have to put together some leaves, and now every time I go, they've already got a place prepared. They know when the white man comes, he's going to need some shelter. And again, that's not a racial statement. That's just a fact. Amen? And that's no big deal in our place. It's only a big deal here to say white man, black man, etc. But anyways, praise the Lord, Kumbin. I said, brother, where did you get that? He says, Holy Spirit told me I need to stay covered. I shouldn't show my nakedness. I said, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Same Holy Spirit. Let me say, next to last, when a missionary comes home, he comes home not only to reconnect, to rehearse, to report, but also to recuperate. Verse 28 says, they abode long time with the disciples. It doesn't tell us how long it was. Some people, their furlough is 6 months. Sometimes it's 12 months. I don't think it ought to be much longer than that. If your health is okay, get back. Amen. But there are sometimes circumstances that delay you where you have to remain back a little longer. It does not give us a time frame, but nonetheless, when a missionary comes home, he comes home to recuperate, to get some rest. Maybe that would be necessary. For me, I'm already rested. I want to get to work. It doesn't take me long. But I tell you what I do need, what I did need, I need some spiritual refreshment. Boy, we were excited to go to a spiritual leadership conference in Lancaster together, my wife and I, in June. Just a couple weeks after we came back. That's one of the reasons why we came back when we did, so we could attend that. We needed some refreshment, spiritual refreshment, so that when we get on the road to come travel and preach and so forth, I'm not in a hospital all the time spiritually. You know what I'm saying? It's good to come home to get some recruitment. And let me say here, I think lastly is to re-enlist. Verse number 36 of chapter 15, Paul said unto Barnabas, and I like to say it this way, hey, Barney, and I'll say it in pidgin, you may go again. Let's go again. Boy, I'm tired of being around here. God's put this fire in my heart. Boy, I've seen the pictures time after time after time. I've seen these people I know. I baptized them. I've seen them one to Christ. They've got a desire to serve. I want to get back and see how they do.
Yeah.
Boy, missionary comes home that he might indeed re-enlist. Re-enlist, get back to the field once again. Well, we could add a few on here about raising support and et cetera, but the missionary comes home, for the most part, I'll say, for these things. Father, thank you for the things you taught me out of this chapter. I pray, Lord, you bless your people with this text. I pray in Jesus' name, amen and amen.